see Hedley Thomas. He is the journalist that was the driving force behind the podcast, The Teacher's Pet, that helped drive so much information in this case. And to the right of Marilyn, you would have seen Damien Poole, one of the key investigators who helped in the charging. Let's listen to Hedley Thomas.
Thank Greg, Marilyn, and Pat for backing the podcast, for supporting me when I wanted to do this story in late 2017 and we started talking. They have been so staunch and they've treated me like a member of their family. I wouldn't have been able to carry on without that kind of backing. And we've had some incredible challenges along the way. I think that we have to really properly acknowledge the incredible job that the prosecutors did to finally bring this case home. Craig Everson, with his team, did an amazing job in the murder trial, and they were obviously only able to do that because of the methodical work done by the Detective Senior Constable Dan Poole from the Police Unsolved Homicide Squad. There's a lot of criticism that's been appropriately made of the police investigation early. You know, Lynn Dawson was missing for 8 years and just treated as a runaway mother for that time when the circumstances were so gravely suspicious. It wouldn't happen today. If something like that happened today, there would be, as Damien Loon, who picked up the investigation and did such an amazing job with it from 1998, as he said, there would be a strike force that would be set up today, and there would be a very strong focus on the spouse. But that didn't happen, and I think that's a reflection of society and how far things have come.
Hedley, one of the great things about journalism is that it can right wrongs. Is that it can give a voice to people who feel powerless. I don't mean this from an egotistical way, but journalism is a holy grail of what you've been able to achieve. Now, not for you personally, but to have been able to use your journalism so a family can get some peace. How emotional does that make you?
Look, it's just such a privilege that I've had that opportunity. I feel incredibly fortunate. I feel like I've even got to know Lynn, although I could never have known her. You know, I was, I guess, 16 when she disappeared, but her story struck me as so unjust, so unfair at the time. And, you know, I think it's true, I did become obsessive about it. I think people who do understand the evidence in this case have the same feeling because it is so immediately unfair. And let's remember, it's taken 40 years for this to happen. Chris Dawson should have been charged 40 years ago. He has had 40 years of his life that he has been able to enjoy without any accountability for what's happened. That's disgraceful, and that's on the system as it existed in the early 1980s. But thankfully, nothing like this would happen again. And I think that the other really powerful point that's come out of all of the publicity and the airing of these allegations and now this finding, this verdict, is that millions of women particularly can call out the kinds of issues that were exposed in The Teacher's Pet and in the relationship and in the evidence brief, and feel more empowered and be able to get some justice, you know, over what they perceive has happened. Also get away from dangerous relationships that could end up becoming fatal. I also want to say, I want to acknowledge Lynn's friends, Lynn's great friends, who also trusted in this podcast and in the media. Sue Strath and Anna Grantham and Barbara Cruz and Julie Andrew, to name just four. They have been magnificent, and Annette Leary, they have remained so loyal and staunch to their friend Lynn Dawson. They always knew that this was crook. They always strongly suspected that Chris Dawson had killed Lynn, but they were not taken seriously early on. they were right.
Hedley, Chris Dawson shook his head very slightly as he was convicted. Do you think he'll remain in denial, or do you think he'll ever acknowledge the fact that he's murdered his wife?
I hope he acknowledges it, and I hope, pick up Greg's point, he does more than that and he leads Lynn's family to her remains. Lynn deserves to be properly buried, and the family need that comfort.
And what about his first night in jail? Do you reckon that's a massive adjustment for someone like
him? Chris faces the rest of his life in jail. He's 74 years old, so he's going to struggle, undoubtedly. But he's had 40 years of freedom too, so let's bear that in mind.
Given the weight of evidence against Chris Dawson, does it surprise you when you see
Not really. I mean, I don't blame members of Chris's family for backing him. You know, they know him one way. The witnesses and evidence perceived him another way. I don't know what happened to Chris Dawson after he murdered his wife, Lynn. I don't know whether he just tried to change his personality, but clearly he was so infatuated by the former student, who I think we should still call JC, that he was driven to do this. And let's also remember, we wouldn't be here talking about this guilty verdict if JC had not had the courage to come forward and tell the police what was going on at the time Lynn disappeared, to raise the suspicions. She was fundamental in that, and the judge accepted almost all of her evidence as truthful. If she hadn't had the guts to do that and expose herself to judgment in the society that followed this case and amongst her peers and others, then we wouldn't be here. And I've never met her, but I think that she deserves incredible kudos and credit for helping get this case to where we are today.
The day went for several hours. Was there a moment, any point, where you thought
it would go away? Many moments. It was a roller coaster, and I know that we heard in the first half hour the judge talking about how he had found Chris Dawson had repeatedly lied, that Lynn Dawson had died on that date, and that she hadn't left the house voluntarily. So you thought, well, we are going to actually see a guilty verdict. But then there were these twists and turns, and it was really draining. I think everyone in the court was exhausted by it. I wasn't in the Banco court, I was in the court that Chris Dawson was in. But I understand that when the verdict was delivered, there was a big cheer and people started hugging. Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And your podcast obviously got taken offline a while ago. Now we have the verdict, just I hope to get it back online, and all those people curious who may not have heard it, you know, 4 years ago, can listen to it now.
Well, that would be a good thing. You know, no journalist likes to see their journalism censored, removed. That's something above my pay grade, but I hope so. I'd be pushing for it.
We have to ask on behalf of the many families who still have unanswered questions. Are you working on something else at the moment?
I have some ideas, and I'm really keen to develop those. Yeah. You only get a case like Lynn Dawson's once a lifetime, though. She's such an incredible... She must have been a wonderful mum and an extraordinarily devoted wife to have stuck fast to Chris despite all of the humiliation and contempt and disrespect with which he treated her. That was quite wicked, but she was fastened on, and again, I think proves the lie that she didn't leave him. Thank you.
Just get a shot of the family there, please.
Powerful words from Hedley Thomas there, who was the driving force behind the Teachers Pet, a podcast that looked into the disappearance of Lyn Dawson, supporting Lyn Dawson's family. That has resulted this afternoon with our breaking news. Chris Dawson has been found guilty of murdering his wife Lynette 40 years ago. Supreme Court Justice Ian Harrison handed down his verdict during a lengthy 4.5-hour hearing today in Sydney.
The circumstantial evidence in this case, considered as a whole, is persuasive and compelling. None of the circumstances considered alone can establish Mr. Dawson's guilt, but when regard is had to their combined force, I am left in no doubt. I am satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that the only rational inference that the circumstances enable me to draw is that Lynette Dawson died on about 8 January 1982 as the result of a conscious and voluntary act committed by Mr. Dawson with the intention of causing her death. Christopher Michael Dawson, on the charge that on or about 8 January 1982 at Bayview or elsewhere in the state of New South Wales, you did murder Lynette Dawson, I find you guilty.